I'm going to teach you about seeding data in Ruby on Rails. So I'm going to tell you what seeds are, I'm going to tell you some horror stories, I'm going to give you some little approaches you can use for seeding, and I'm also going to give you a little cheeky tip on how you can test your seeds, which is pretty awesome. Before I start, I just want you to remind you, please like, comment, and subscribe on this video. It helps me so much, and it's always appreciated. So what are seeds? You've probably seen them around. They are little bits of data we use to kind of like give our development environments or preview environments something good to look at, so like a user to log in as, maybe a few posts, maybe like a little bit of data which is needed for like the app to work. In Rails, we have this little command called Rails dbseed, and you normally run it, and we should be able to run this multiple times without too much worry, and that will add that data to the database. It also runs when you run bin setup, if you've ever had a look at that file. I do recommend it, it's good fun in there. So where are they stored? Well, if you ever create an app, there's a little file called db and then seeds down here, and that is where they live. It's normally on a blank install. It'll look something like this, where you have basically a commented section, and it's not like the nicest looking seeds. They're like just cranks and movies, and they're not very realistic as to real life. If I'm lucky, normally I'd find something like this where someone's kind of set up a default user for me to log in as, and it's set up, and it will only run in maybe the development environment. That's quite cool. I like that. That always makes me happy to see that. Something I can log in on. Then every once in a while, I'll also come across something where some kind of data which needs to be in the database, but it's unclear like when the seeds were made, and maybe another developer will come along and tell me that, hey, these are actually really, really, really out of date, don't run them. We'll give you a copy of production to use instead. And that's always a bit of a worry when I hear that. So let's have a quick horror story. So a long, long time ago, one of my friends was working on a project, and then they didn't have a copy, like a good local development copy of the database. They didn't have seeds. Instead, they gave him a production copy. So they took a dump from production. They gave it to him. He put it on his laptop. And he was working away quite happily. Everything was going well. And he put his laptop in his bag, went home, got home, and found the laptop was missing. So at that point, he's just lost a copy of all the production data. And that's really embarrassing. Yeah, I think they had to call the customer and tell them what happened, and it was all a bit bad. So this was so avoidable. If they had decent seeds, they could have just, it would have been, sure, the code would have gone missing, but at least the data would be safe, and they could have done all the stuff around it. The next story I've got is, I was working on a project where the customer wanted to see real data in their preview environments. They had a staging environment. And so we copied the production database onto staging. The user was pretty happy. They were clicking around. Then like a few weeks later, they requested to be able to email real users or have that environment actually email users. That was just so they could email themselves. However, there was a cron job running in the environment where it would just email users every Monday morning, just about what happened that week. And yeah, long story short, our staging environment just emailed every user in the database, and they all started logging in as well, which was really scary. And I couldn't help but think the whole time, had we changed those email addresses, had we anonymized a bit of data, well, that would have been avoided completely. Finally, one of the other things like I feel like good seeds really, really are helpful for, just giving a better user experience. But there's nothing worse than taking on a new project and you set it up, you do bundle, you set up the database of RakeDB setup, you go to open it and there's nothing there, it's blank. It's an empty project, it's blank pages. And it's like, what makes you think that the previous developers didn't care. And if they just put in some seeds, it would be so much better. Let's talk about some approaches to seeding. So I'm going to go through five ways that you could Seizure app. They hopefully shouldn't be too much of a shock, but I hope they should be quite fun. So, explicitly defined seeds. This is probably what you've seen. So, this is where you've got your DB seeds file, and maybe you put something in it, and maybe you break them down a little bit using the previous examples we had, or maybe you chop them into other files. And that works pretty good, but I find that once a website gets to a certain level of complexity, that just doesn't work anymore. It's just you have this giant file. It's like a thousand lines long, and it's just intimidating for everyone. No one wants it. However, you could also use this gem called Seedbank, which to kind of help manage the mess, which works quite well. I would recommend it, though it hasn't been updated for about 2 years, so be wary. One thing I do really like doing right now is I use Faker to generate seeds. And by this, I mean this Faker gem, which you've probably seen about. What I do is I drop in this little bits of data in it, and I cycle random stuff. So if I ever just reset my database, I can just suddenly have something a bit more fresher, a bit more unique each time. Normally this catches some quite interesting stuff. And the key thing I do also is I add this EMV where it's like during release seed user. Well, that's great because I can then run it in a staging environment. I can just reset, I can truncate the database and run it again, which is super cool. I would highly recommend doing that. So it makes it very, very fun. One thing I discovered about recently was you can actually seed your database using your fixtures, which is kind of interesting. I've never, ever seen it in the wild. From what I gather, it can give you problems with foreign keys. But it is possible. You can run Rails DB fixtures load and put in a user. You could also potentially loop through your factories, which you've created using FactoryBot, but ThoughtBot doesn't recommend it because it's not quite perfect. I've, again, never seen that in the wild. I just thought it was kind of interesting. So this is where it gets really cool. Okay, so when you start getting really big data sets, what you really want to do is just pull down maybe one user to look at and all of their associated stuff. Like maybe you're looking into an error or something and you want to recreate the environment to have a look locally. And Evil Seed is kind of a good technique for doing that. It's quite like you can create a little dump of maybe a bit of data, like maybe look at users who were last logged in the last 2 days and have a look at what they've been up to. That's quite cool. And you can even anonymize some of the data. So if you were to lose it, it's fine. It's not the end of the world. It's not going to have that user's real data in it. Obviously, it's a little bit hard to keep up to date. You still have to be mindful of what's going on. But I really like this approach. I think it's very, very sensible. Finally, I'm a big fan of this using a Ruby object for storing my data. So hear me out on this. I've not seen many other people do this, but I've really started to like this. So this is where, say you've got some data and it needs to be in all your environments. It makes so much sense just to create like an object, like a model where it just kind of knows about what the data should look like and it pulls it up and stores it in memory. So this is kind of an example of how you might use it, I really like this approach. It's like kind of my favorite thing right now, because if data needs to be the same across all environments, why not just kind of put it in memory and store it as a plain Ruby object, and it'll be definitely there. You can actually test seeds. This is really cool. So this is something I started doing on a few projects, and I'd literally just go in and check they ran successfully. This tiny, what is this, like 8 lines of code, something like that, has saved my ass so many times, or at least made me feel confident in the code I'm writing that the test will fail if the seeds can't run, because, you know, we've got the safety barrier there. I highly recommend this little bit of code. It really makes me very, very happy. So what is the best way you can approach seeds? Well, I think a lot of it is coming from a mindset of knowing that you want to have good seeds and you want to have a good environment and you want to make other developers who use your code happy. So make sure you can run your DB seed command multiple times without fear of it going wrong. So just keep running it. Again, you've got the test to check it works, and you know it'll work. I'd also totally recommend setting up a preview environment. So that's like staging or maybe a review app if you use Heroku. If you're using Faker to generate a bunch of like tables or data in there, then you've instantly got an incentive to make it look good and make it like full. This is kind of like a nice win, because then locally in development, you'll have a nice thing to look at. When you show your project to other developers, they'll have something nice to look up, which might even be different. So they might catch something, which is quite cool. And then also it'll be different for each time, which is very nice. Also, like, if it's going to be in all the environments and it's going to be the same data, just don't put it in the database. Just put it somewhere else. Like, I've been putting them in plain Ruby objects, and that has worked for me. Lastly, if you're taking dumps of production, I would just be super wary about anyone doing that. It's not 2010 anymore. We know better than to be logging into production, playing around with commands, and like running off of all this data. What you really want to be doing is be taking really concise, like, I want this user, I want some information about them, I'm going to let everyone know what I'm up to, and I'm going to anonymize the bits I don't care about, because that's the important thing. That's kind of my advice there. So if you have any questions, please send me a message on Twitter. I'm MikeRogers0, or check out my website, MikeRogers.ai. Other than that, thank you for watching.